The rulers of the United Arab Emirates have insane amounts of money to spend. Thanks to everyone's thirst for oil, they've been on a construction spree unlike any the world has ever seen for such a small country, investing in one ambitious infrastructure project after another. At one point, 24% of all the world's construction cranes were in Dubai. Unfortunately, that was before the 2008 global financial meltdown, which led to much of the investment in the city drying up faster than the water on somebody who just got out of the pool at the Burj Khalifa. But the government insists that many of these projects have simply been delayed, and are putting their money where their mouth is, with the recent approval of a $32 billion expansion of Dubai's Al Maktoum International Airport that will break ground by the end of 2014. When complete, it'll suddenly have the capacity to become the busiest airport in the world in both total passengers at 220 million a year and total cargo of 12 million annual tons of goods that can move through it. That's almost three times more than what takes off from the runways of the world's current leading airport, Hong Kong International. Dubai's terminals will be able to greet 100 of the massive new Airbus A380s at a time. Those things are two-thirds of a football field long and cost $300 million a pop. And the UAE's Emirates Airline already owns more of those planes than anyone else in the world. It's the largest airline in the Middle East, and will eventually move into the Al Maktoum to help jumpstart activity there. The government's plan is for the airfield to be the heartbeat of a city within the larger city of Dubai. This littler city is called World Central, which the UAE thinks will be home to around 900,000 residents in the near future. The airport also aims to be the central hub for the emerging Middle East, North African, and South Asian economic bloc known as MENASA. But time will tell whether the Sheikh's vision for Dubai actually becomes a reality or fades like some vicious mirage. This is Songdo International Business District, the world's most futuristic urban area. It's being built 40 miles southwest of the second most populated city in the world, Seoul, South Korea. The $40 billion project is along the waterfront in the city of Incheon, and is embracing two key concepts that urban planners are in love with. The first is Aerotropolis, which means the airport is integrated into the urban center instead of banishing it far outside the city. This allows for shorter trips to and from the place that's going to get you out of town. This will be an emerging pattern in 21st century planning as air travel continues to become accessible to more and more people in our increasingly interconnected world. Songdo is brilliantly directly connected to the airport via the 7-mile-long Incheon Bridge. So you've just got a straight shot that gets you there in like 10 minutes. It's also got these incredible views, which is the first thing visitors see coming into the city. The other key theme is ubiquitous city, which is a uniquely Korean concept where every device, component, service is linked to an informational network through wireless computing technology, allowing for greater coordination and a more efficient and synchronized city than has ever been possible before. An example of this is Songdo's trash system, which won't rely on garbage trucks because a network of tubes will suck in the garbage straight from the can and through a system of pipes, transport it efficiently to treatment facilities. Songdo's so dedicated to being a model for sustainability that it's set aside 40% of its land area to be outdoor spaces like parks, and it'll become the first city in the world outside of the United States to achieve LEED certification, which is the highest energy consumption and waste standards possible with currently available technology. As a tip of the hat to other great cities, Songdo will also incorporate replicas of New York's Central Park and Venice's historic canals. Overall, construction is currently half done. It already has 67,000 people living there, studying and working at its many schools, including the foreign campuses of four American universities. But it's struggled to attract Korean businesses, as the government is refusing to give tax incentives for relocation because that would create an unfair playing field, favoring Songdo over other cities in the country. Still, if it stays squarely focused on the future, Songdo's a long-term investment that's likely to pay off. Nicaragua is about to embark on what may be the riskiest megaproject in the world, one that will change it forever. It's going to build the biggest canal on the planet. The $50 billion Nicaragua Grand Canal will cut the country in half to connect the Atlantic Ocean with the Pacific, running through the biggest lake in Central America. At 173 miles long, it'll dwarf the 120-mile-long Suez Canal in Egypt, and directly compete with the Panama Canal 250 miles to the south, through which more than 15,000 ships already pass each year. But in the coming years, many more ships full of goods and raw materials are going to try and pass back and forth from the Pacific to the Atlantic to connect Europe, Brazil, and the eastern coast of the United States with China and the rest of Asia. The story of how little 6-million-man Nicaragua, the second poorest country in the Western Hemisphere, is able to afford such an expensive project is a fascinating case study of globalization and how capitalism is increasingly driving geopolitical decision-making. In June of last year, Nicaraguan President Daniel Ortega's Sandinista Party also controlled parliament and, without any real debate, gave a 50-year no-bid contract to Chinese telecommunications magnate Wang Jing to build and manage the proposed canal. And it just so happens that, also last year, according to a report in the LA Times, Wang hosted a number of Nicaraguan officials and businessmen on a trip to China, where the powerful and connected Wang supposedly flaunted his extreme wealth and was accompanied at all times by Chinese military officers and other high-ranking governmental officials. So it's tough to believe him when he insists that the Chinese government is not financially backing the project, especially when we already know that China is using state-financed companies to buy more and more assets in the West. The opportunity to own the world's most valuable shipping lane seems too tempting for the Chinese government to pass up. The supposedly democratic government of Nicaragua is using a page out of China's playbook by refusing to release any of the studies about the impacts of the canal until December 2014, the same month construction will begin. That's because there's a long list of environmental and humanitarian concerns. The project will tear through countless ecosystems and communities and rip into the source of much of the country's freshwater, Lake Nicaragua. The residents whose land is on the canal route have received no word on what the government plans to do for them in terms of compensation and relocation. But as easy as it is to criticize the way the project is being handled, it's also fairly hypocritical of me, as an American, to mount a very convincing argument against the plan. After all, about 100 years ago, US President Theodore Roosevelt basically took control of Panama and pushed through the canal there, a project that's benefited America time and time again, and has made Panama economically better off in the long run. But we're not living in 1914. Now is the time of social media-fueled revolution, where images and video fly around the world instantly, empowering even the poorest locals to use the power of the global community to rally support for their cause and exert political pressure in unpredictable ways. So, what I'm saying is that it may have been easy for President Ortega to see all that money flying around and secretly, single-handedly, approve a massively disruptful project like this, but when those bulldozers start tearing apart the countryside and people's homes, there's probably going to be hell to pay for not consulting the voters at all. This could be shaping up to be another one of those important moments of struggle in world history between the powerful haves and the have-nots. On the one hand, you have the limitless funding of the Chinese who want that flag-in-the-dirt statement-making moment for their country of staking a claim in the Americas. We know the canal would benefit corporations in the West through the shipping and trade benefits I outlined earlier. And with construction set to begin in Nicaragua next month, there doesn't seem to be any stopping it from starting. But on the other hand, this thing is going to take 6 years, at a minimum, to finish. And if we've learned anything from recent history, it's that a lot can happen in 6 weeks or 6 months, let alone 6 years. On a person-to-person basis, the United Arab Emirates has the biggest ecological footprint in the world, thanks to its prolific oil production and the massive construction boom that's been going on there for the last decade. So it's surprising to learn that the UAE is home to Masdar, the world's first zero-carbon, zero-waste city. To meet this ambitious goal, it's powered only by renewable energy, like a 54-acre, 88,000-panel solar farm beyond the city's walls. That's right, I said walls. The designers studied ancient cities to learn the most effective planning methods to reduce energy consumption. One of the key things they found are that walls help to keep the high, hot desert winds away from cities' inhabitants. They also raised the entire foundation of the site a few feet above the surrounding land to keep Masdar cooler and spaced the buildings much closer together to keep the streets and walkways narrow and mostly in the shade. These techniques, combined with 130-foot-tall wind towers that suck air from above and convert it into a cool breeze blowing on the street, mean Masdar is a comfortable 70 degrees Fahrenheit when, just a few meters away, the thermostat rises well above 100. Plus, there's no driving in the city, and any car that enters is parked at the outskirts. A system of driverless electric vehicles then ferry people from place to place underground, and a light rail system is also available above ground, which means there's no need for streets. And in a move that cuts both water and electricity consumption more than half, there are no light switches or water taps. Everything is controlled by movement sensors. This unprecedented level of environmental consciousness has won it hard-earned endorsements from environmental conservation groups like Greenpeace and the World Wildlife Fund. The German engineering giant Siemens has located its Middle East headquarters there, as has the International Renewable Energy Agency. The Masdar Institute for Science and Technology, a small postgraduate university that was founded through a collaboration with MIT, occupies one of Masdar's first completed buildings, and is already producing great work and first-class researchers. So the city undeniably has a solid foundation, but it's got a lot to do still if it's going to meet its ambitious goal of housing 50,000 residents and hosting offices for 60,000 more commuters. The city's co-founder admits that Masdar is, quote, a fraction of what it was supposed to be back in 2006 when we announced it. At the beginning of the project, nobody really anticipated how difficult it is to build a city, end quote. This underscores the point many urban planners around the world have made, that we should be focused on making our existing cities more sustainable instead of building brand new ones. But even if Masdar only teaches us one or two major things about what's possible when it comes to sustainable urban design, and it does seem like it's already done that, then it'll have been worth it, even if it takes much longer to achieve its overall vision, or if it ultimately fails. Because let's be honest, the UAE was going to spend that $20 billion in oil revenue on something, so it's better for everyone that it's going to an important experiment like Masdar rather than another row of gold and marble-crusted hotel skyscrapers or an electricity-sucking indoor snow park. This is the future. Maglev trains. Japan's all aboard. They're spending a staggering $85 billion over the next 30 years to connect the island's three largest cities, Tokyo to Nagoya to Osaka. That's over 300 miles that you'll be able to cover in about 67 minutes by racing through the countryside at over 300 miles per hour. Maglev technology uses powerful magnetic charges to move rail cars that float several inches above a concrete guideway, rather than riding on steel wheels. This frictionless system allows for a smoother ride at significantly higher speeds than traditional high-speed rail. In contrast, California's planned high-speed rail system that'll eventually connect San Francisco, LA, and San Diego will only be able to travel at top speeds of 220 miles per hour, but its estimated overall cost is $10 billion less than the Japanese system and will cover a distance 2.5 times as long. The Chinese city of Shanghai has had a short maglev line in operation since 2004, but the Japanese line is the world's first intercity link to gain public approval. The project's called Chuo Shinkansen, or as the Japanese refer to it, Rinia Motoka, and is a culmination of 40 years of Japanese maglev development that began with an unlikely partnership between Japan Airlines and Japanese National Railways. What's really impressive about this project is that JR Central, the company that's building the line, will finance the project without public money, thanks largely to the success of the bullet train it's run from Tokyo to Osaka since the mid-1960s. The company's also pushing hard to construct a maglev line between the American capital city of Washington, D.C. and New York, which would showcase the technology to the American market and the rest of the Western world. The Japanese government has even offered to fully finance the 40-mile first leg of the US project from Baltimore to DC, a proposal Prime Minister Shinzo Abe directly pitched to President Barack Obama during a meeting last year. But critics of maglev say the costs outweigh the benefits. Opponents have raised questions about the sheer monetary cost of the project, its environmental impact, and whether it's really needed at all. tunnels will be blasted through some of Japan's highest mountains to build the Chuo Shinkansen line. But regardless of what the critics say, something had to change. When the Maglev system is done, it will help alleviate the overcrowding on Japan's existing rail system and make it feasible for commuters into Tokyo to live further outside of the city than they can now. Many of the projects that we've profiled in our Mega Project series have a real purpose for advancing society, or at least meeting the needs of a growing world economy. Then there's Azerbaijan's ridiculous Khazar Islands, a project that, despite all the progress in the world, is the perfect example of everything that's still wrong with its power structure, but more on that in a moment. The creatively named Azerbaijan Tower will be the world's tallest building, about 800 feet taller than the current leader, the Burj Khalifa, and insanely twice as tall as the tallest building in the Western Hemisphere, New York's One World Trade Center. The Freudian showpiece of the $100 billion project, Azerbaijan Tower, will rise above the capital city, Baku, and it'll be surrounded by 55 artificial islands built in the Caspian Sea, with land gathered by completely destroying a nearby mountain. There will also be at least 8 hotels, a Formula One racetrack, a yacht club, and an airport. So basically, we're talking about Donald Trump's fantasy. Now, it's one thing to build an over-the-top city like Dubai in the United Arab Emirates, which is one of the most developed places in the world, and a completely different thing for it to rise in Azerbaijan, which has a per capita GDP that's not even one-fifth as much as the UAE. This madness is the brainchild of the billionaire developer Ibrahim Ibrahimov, who has extremely close ties with the corrupt government of the newly oil-rich nation of Azerbaijan. Just how corrupt is Azerbaijan? In a 2012 report by watchdog Transparency International that declared two-thirds of the world's countries highly corrupt, Azerbaijan's Prez Ilham Aliyev stood out from the pack as the report's infamous person of the year, with untold amounts of money stashed in various locations around the world. But back to President Aliyev's good buddy, Ibrahimov, who lazily came up with the tacky idea for the mega project that's basically a copy of Dubai's island development and mega tower while on a flight home from, you guessed it, Dubai. He argues that Khazar Islands will be home to 800,000 people, but doesn't explain how those people will afford its expensive apartments. Instead of investing in the future by maybe funding a network of world-class universities, which Azerbaijan isn't even close to having, in a country that borders no ocean and produces no product that the rest of the world wants besides oil, the government thinks it's a good idea to build this. I doubt many of the 9 million people of Azerbaijan think it's a very good idea. In fact, in a possible sign of things to come, last year, Azerbaijanis, in a city across the country, got so fed up with the corrupt regime, they rioted for 2 entire days. But look, the capital is doing some things right. Baku made Lonely Planet's top 10 ranking of the best nightlife spots in the world. I just wonder how much they paid to get on that list. No list of mega projects would be complete without including the largest ever science project. The International Thermonuclear Experimental Reactor, or ITER, is a collaboration between China, the European Union, India, Japan, Russia, South Korea, and the United States that is under construction in southern France, where researchers will attempt to see if they can, essentially, recreate the power of the sun and harness it in a steel bottle. Gas will be heated to over 150 million degrees in a massive steel frame using giant magnets that will force some atoms together. In this experimental reactor, the hope is to produce 10 times more energy than what is used to initiate the reaction, or the equivalent of 500 megawatts of power for 1,000 seconds. Although electricity won't be generated at the ITER facility, a fusion plant based on this design would use the heat generated to drive turbines and produce power. Unlike nuclear fission, which are what all nuclear power plants are today, fusion reactors should be completely safe, with no risk of producing a runaway chain reaction and no dangerous long-living radioactive waste. The fact that nations who are competing in nearly every area of geopolitics and economics are coming together to collaborate on a $50 billion project is a sign that the science is incredibly promising and the potential benefits to humanity are profoundly game-changing. That's why countries that represent half the world's population and account for two-thirds of the global economy are participating, because solving fusion would mean prosperity for all, the closest thing to limitless energy we can fathom. This month, after the completion of the ground support structure, which took 4 years to finish, the second phase of construction began. The walls of the seven-story building where the experiment will take place. But we're still several years away from turning the thing on. The complex will make its first attempt to produce plasma in a fusion reaction in 2020, with regular operations beginning in 2027, 11 years behind schedule and over 40 years after the program was first initiated in 1985. But no matter how long or how many tries it takes to get it right, the hope of living in a world powered by this type of energy that we wouldn't need to fight over or pump out of the ground, that we wouldn't need to burn, that wouldn't harm our precious planet, that's probably one of the most optimistic, hopeful ideas I've ever heard, and it's definitely one worth waiting for. China is about halfway done building the largest expressway system in the world, and it's been doing so at a feverish pace over the last 25 years to keep up with the rise of the automobile as the country, and the world, has shifted away from a rail-based transportation system. The first expressway within the National Trunk Highway System, as it's called, opened in 1988, and today, just 26 years later, the system is over 65,000 miles long. In the 10 years since 2004, the network has tripled in length. Each year, China is now building new expressways equivalent in length to the distance of going coast to coast and back in the United States. The Chinese system exceeded the total length of the US interstate highway system back in 2011. This crazy expansion has happened because the Chinese have embraced the car at a staggering pace. This next mind-blowing fact pretty much sums up this entire video. As the country's middle class boomed and tens of millions of people suddenly could afford to buy cars, in the 20 years from 1985 to 2005, the number of passenger vehicles in China increased from 19,000 to 62 million cars on the road. That's a mind-blowing increase of 323,000%. And that 62 million number is more than tripling to 200 million by 2020. That's why we've seen those stories that I thought were a joke the first time I read them, of traffic jams around Beijing stretching over 60 miles and lasting for 11 days. So this project is sorely needed, simply for the country to function. When it's finished, it'll have cut total travel times between cities throughout the country by half on average. Overall, the total cost of building the entire system is $240 billion. That's easily the biggest infrastructure project in human history, with $12 billion a year being invested through 2020. It's being able to afford to do this without adding a national fuel tax, because 95% of the system are toll roads owned by private, for-profit companies. This is a problem, as tolls are expensive at over 10 cents per mile, which is more than the cost of fuel itself. But regardless of how the roads are paid for, or whether you drive in them in your gas or electric car, or ride in a self-driving car in the future, the Chinese economy and quality of life of its people will be significantly better thanks to this ambitious project. It seems the whole country is embracing the Chinese saying, Lutong Keitan, wealth follows the extension of motorways. India faces one of the most challenging situations in the world. It has 1.2 billion people spread over a vast country, more than 350 million of whom will move into cities in the coming decade, which means some 500 new urban centers will need to be built from scratch. And even though India's sheer size means that its economy ranks third in the world in purchasing power, overall it's relatively poor and underdeveloped. It's also young. The average Indian is just 27 years old, compared to the average American, who's a decade older. This means that most of the population is about to hit their prime working years. These are all people who need jobs to be created now. That's why the government is embarking on the largest infrastructure project in Indian history, the $90 billion Delhi-Mumbai Industrial Corridor, whose backbone will be a 920-mile-long dedicated freight corridor. Basically, a set of multiple rail lines that will exist solely to move goods from the factories where they are produced to the sea and airports where they can be exported to market. It's designed to cut the logistical costs of manufacturing goods to make India the cheapest place in the world for a company to build its stuff, and in turn, triple the amount of merchandise it exports from 2010 levels by 2017. Japan is the major partner behind the project because the Japanese economy is based on a technology industry that needs to build its products at the most competitive rates in the world. The overall effort will include a 4,000 megawatt power plant and at least 3 brand new seaports and 6 airports. And all along the route, 24 new cities will spring up, with each aiming to be superior to any existing Indian city in terms of the quality of infrastructure, planning, management, and services offered. With natural resources scarce and climate change a concern of any good urban planner, the use of technology has been stressed to make sure this boom will be as clean and sustainable as possible. Roads are also a major part of the plan, with thousands of miles of expressways planned to ease congestion. The project is a priority of Prime Minister Narendra Modi, who entered office in 2014 after leading his BJP party to a dominating win in the 2014 election, giving him a mandate to enact his vision for making India a global manufacturing superpower. It seems the Indians are attempting to follow a similar blueprint for success the Chinese put into action over the last 40 years. With a population nearly as big, Indians are rightly asking, why not us? If you were playing SimCity, you'd want to go about building your metropolis the same way the Saudis have with King Abdullah Economic City. And just like other great leaders of men, you'd probably name it after yourself too, which is exactly what King Abdullah did. You'd also focus on job-creating infrastructure and a dream university to attract the best and brightest. Saudi Arabia is the world's dominant oil producer and is a country that knows how to play the game. While its flashier neighbors like Abu Dhabi and Dubai get all the publicity for their mega projects, the kingdom is embarking on a far more ambitious project that's focused squarely on creating the most cohesive, well-planned city in the Arab world. The $100 billion enterprise on the coast of the Red Sea is about an hour's drive north of Jeddah, the second largest city in Saudi Arabia, and plans to expand into an area about the size of Washington, D.C. That location is no coincidence, says Fahd al-Rashid, the man who's in charge of growing King Abdullah Economic City, which we're going to just shorten to its initials KAEC for the purpose of this video. Quote, "You're talking about 24% of global trade going through the Red Sea, and this is a trend that's never been addressed by a Red Sea port." End quote. That's why KAEC's port is going to be massive, with an annual capacity of over 10 million shipping containers, which would make it one of the busiest ports in the world. So cargo is KAEC's first major transportation hub. The second is Haramain Station, one of 4 stops on Saudi Arabia's planned high-speed rail network that will connect the new megacity to Jeddah, Mecca, and Medina. This will bring thousands of visitors to KAEC right from its inception, with officials hoping that some will naturally take jobs and stay there, fueling its expansion. At first, the whole plan struggled to gain much traction with investors, but, says al-Rashid, then we reoriented ourselves toward building that demand, creating that support, and it's completely shifted. Now we have captive demand, all our apartments are full, and we have waiting lists for hundreds of people, literally." End quote. Part of that shift focused on KAEC's Industrial Valley, which is centered on a large petrochemical plant and has more than 70 countries lining up to set up bases there. And then there's the cornerstone of any thriving city, a great university. Enter King Abdullah University of Science and Technology, which began instruction in 2009 with a staggering $20 billion endowment, making it the 3rd best-funded university in the world behind Harvard and Yale. This capital injection has allowed it to lift off like a rocket in its first 5 years. It's recruited some of the best talent from over 60 countries around the world, scientists who've carried the school to an eye-opening 99.9% research record score. The research teams at King Tech are advancing many important fields like solar cell technology and cancer therapy. It teaches in English and is the first mixed-gender university in the kingdom. Plus, with just 1,200 postgraduates on an 8,900-acre campus, there's plenty of room to expand in every direction. With 40% of Saudi Arabia's citizens under 15 years old, the plan is for the megacity, by itself, to create upwards of 1 million jobs for all of those young people to grow into. In the end, it may be true that Saudi Arabia would be a bone-dry desert wasteland without its exploitation of the vast fields of black gold underneath it, but at least in the twilight of his life, King Abdullah is doing all he can to set his people and the rest of the world on a slightly better path than the one they were on when he took over just 9 years ago in 2005. And if that's his legacy, he deserves to have a city named after him. Thanks for watching. I hope you enjoyed this video, and if you did, you'll love our video profiling 10 promising renewable energy sources of the future, or our mini doc on robotic armies and the militaries of the future. Make sure to like this video to help it spread, it really helps us out, and hit that subscribe button to stay up to date on all of our daily videos. For TDC, I'm Bryce Plank. The rulers of the United Arab Emirates have insane amounts of money to spend. Thanks to everyone's thirst for oil, they've been on a construction spree unlike any the world has ever seen for such a small country, investing in one ambitious infrastructure project after another. At one point, 24% of all the world's construction cranes were in Dubai. Unfortunately, that was before the 2008 global financial meltdown, which led to much of the investment in the city drying up faster than the water on somebody who just got out of the pool at the Burj Khalifa. But the government insists that many of these projects have simply been delayed, and are putting their money where their mouth is, with the recent approval of a $32 billion expansion of Dubai's Al Maktoum International Airport that will break ground by the end of 2014. When complete, it'll suddenly have the capacity to become the busiest airport in the world in both total passengers at 220 million a year and total cargo of 12 million annual tons of goods that can move through it. That's almost 3 times more than what takes off from the runways of the world's current leading airport, Hong Kong International. Dubai's terminals will be able to greet 100 of the massive new Airbus A380s at a time. Those things are 2/3 of a football field long and cost $300 million a pop. And the UAE's Emirates Airline already owns more of those planes than anyone else in the world. It's the largest airline in the Middle East and will eventually move into the Al Maktoum to help jumpstart activity there. The government's plan is for the airfield to be the heartbeat of a city within the larger city of Dubai. This littler city is called World Central, which the UAE thinks will be home to around 900,000 residents in the near future. The airport also aims to be the central hub for the emerging Middle East, North African, and South Asian economic bloc known as MENASA. But time will tell whether the Sheikh's vision for Dubai actually becomes a reality or fades like some vicious mirage. This is Songdo International Business District, the world's most futuristic urban area. It's being built 40 miles southwest of the second most populated city in the world, Seoul, South Korea. The $40 billion project is along the waterfront in the city of Incheon, and is embracing two key concepts that urban planners are in love with. The first is Aerotropolis, which means the airport is integrated into the urban center instead of banishing it far outside of the city. This allows for shorter trips to and from the place that's going to get you out of town. This will be an emerging pattern in 21st century planning as air travel continues to become accessible to more and more people and are going to be held to pay for not consulting the voters at all. This could be shaping up to be another one of those important moments of struggle in world history between the powerful haves and the have-nots. On the one hand, you have the limitless funding of the Chinese who want that flag-in-the-dirt statement-making moment for their country of staking a claim in the Americas. We know the canal would benefit corporations in the West through the shipping and trade benefits I outlined earlier. And with construction set to begin in Nicaragua next month, there doesn't seem to be any stopping it from starting. But on the other hand, this thing is going to take 6 years, at a minimum, to finish. And if we've learned anything from recent history, it's that a lot can happen in 6 weeks or 6 months, let alone 6 years. On On a person-to-person basis, the United Arab Emirates has the biggest ecological footprint in the world, thanks to its prolific oil production and the massive construction boom that's been going on there for the last decade. So it's surprising to learn that the UAE is home to Masdar, the world's first zero-carbon, zero-waste city. To meet this ambitious goal, it's powered only by renewable energy, like a 54-acre, 88,000-panel solar farm beyond the city's walls. That's right, I said walls. The designers studied ancient cities to learn the most effective planning methods to reduce energy consumption. One of the key things they found are that walls help to keep the high, hot desert winds away from cities' inhabitants. They also raised the entire foundation of the site a few feet above the surrounding land to keep Masdar cooler and spaced the buildings much closer together to keep the streets and walkways narrow and mostly in the shade. These techniques, combined with 130-foot-tall wind towers that suck air from above and convert it into a cool breeze blowing on the street, mean Masdar is a comfortable 70 degrees Fahrenheit when, just a few meters away, the thermostat rises well above 100. Plus, there's no driving in the city, and any car that enters is parked at the outskirts. A system of driverless electric vehicles then ferry people from place to place underground, and a light rail system is also available above ground, which means there's no need for streets. And in a move that cuts both water and electricity consumption more than half, there are no light switches or water taps. Everything is controlled by movement sensors. This unprecedented level of environmental consciousness has won it hard-earned endorsements from environmental conservation groups like Greenpeace and the World Wildlife Fund. The German engineering giant Siemens has located its Middle East headquarters there, as has the International Renewable Energy Agency. The Masdar Institute for Science and Technology, a small postgraduate university that was founded through a collaboration with MIT, occupies one of Masdar's first completed buildings, and is already producing great work and first-class researchers. So the city undeniably has a solid foundation, but it's got a lot to do still if it's going to meet its ambitious goal of housing 50,000 residents and hosting offices for 60,000 more commuters. The city's co-founder admits that Masdar is, quote, a fraction of what it was supposed to be back in 2006 when we announced it. At the beginning of the project, nobody really anticipated how difficult it is to build a city, end quote. This underscores the point many urban planners around the world have made, that we should be focused on making our existing cities more sustainable instead of building brand new ones. But even if Masdar only teaches us one or two major things about what's possible when it comes to sustainable urban design, and it does seem like it's already done that, then it'll have been worth it, even if it takes much longer to achieve its overall vision, or if it ultimately fails. Because let's be honest, the UAE was going to spend that $20 billion in oil revenue on something, so it's better for everyone that it's going to an important experiment like Masdar rather than another row of gold and marble-crusted hotel skyscrapers or an electricity-sucking indoor snow park. This is the future, maglev trains. Japan's all aboard. They're spending a staggering $85 billion over the next 30 years to connect the island's three largest cities, Tokyo to Nagoya to Osaka. That's over 300 miles that you'll be able to cover in about 67 minutes by racing through the countryside at over 300 miles per hour. Maglev technology uses powerful magnetic charges to move rail cars that float several inches above a concrete guideway, rather than riding on steel wheels. This frictionless system allows for a smoother ride at significantly higher speeds than traditional high-speed rail. In contrast, California's planned high-speed rail system that'll eventually connect San Francisco, LA, and San Diego will only be able to travel at top speeds of 220 miles per hour, but its estimated overall cost is $10 billion less than the Japanese system and will cover a distance 2.5 times as long. The Chinese city of Shanghai has had a short maglev line in operation since 2004, but the Japanese line is the world's first intercity link to gain public approval. The project's called Chuo Shinkansen, or as increasingly interconnected world. Songdo is brilliantly directly connected to the airport via the 7-mile-long Incheon Bridge, so you've just got a straight shot that gets you there in like 10 minutes. It's also got these incredible views, which is the first thing visitors see coming into the city. The other key theme is ubiquitous city, which is a uniquely Korean concept where every device, component, service is linked to an informational network through wireless computing technology, allowing for greater coordination and a more efficient and synchronized city than has ever been possible before. An example of this is Songdo's trash system, which won't rely on garbage trucks because a network of tubes will suck in the garbage straight from the can and through a system of pipes, transport it efficiently to treatment facilities. Songdo's so dedicated to being a model for sustainability that it's set aside 40% of its land area to be outdoor spaces like parks, and it'll become the first city in the world outside of the United States to achieve LEED certification, which is the highest energy consumption and waste standards possible with currently available technology. As a tip of the hat to other great cities, Songdo will also incorporate replicas of New York's Central Park and Venice's historic canals. Overall, construction is currently half done. It already has 67,000 people living there, studying and working at its many schools, including the foreign campuses of four American universities. But it's struggled to attract Korean businesses, as the government is refusing to give tax incentives for relocation because that would create an unfair playing field, favoring Songdo over other cities in the country. Still, if it stays squarely focused on the future, Songdo's a long-term investment that's likely to pay off. Nicaragua is about to embark on what may be the riskiest megaproject in the world, one that will change it forever. It's going to build the biggest canal on the planet. The $50 billion Nicaragua Grand Canal will cut the country in half to connect the Atlantic Ocean with the Pacific, running through the biggest lake in Central America. At 173 miles long, it'll dwarf the 120 mile long Suez Canal in Egypt, and directly compete with the Panama Canal 250 miles to the south, through which more than 15,000 ships already pass each year. But in the coming years, many more ships full of goods and raw materials are going to try and pass back and forth from the Pacific to the Atlantic to connect Europe, Brazil, and the eastern coast of the United States with China and the rest of Asia. The story of how little 6-million-man Nicaragua, the second poorest country in the Western Hemisphere, is able to afford such an expensive project is a fascinating case study of globalization, and how capitalism is increasingly driving geopolitical decision-making. In June of last year, Nicaraguan President Daniel Ortega's Sandinista Party also controlled parliament, and without any real debate, gave a 50-year no-bid contract to Chinese telecommunications magnate Wang Jing to build and manage the proposed canal. And it just so happens that, also last year, according to a report in the LA Times, Wang hosted a number of Nicaraguan officials and businessmen on a trip to China, where the powerful and connected Wang supposedly flaunted his extreme wealth and was accompanied at all times by Chinese military officers and other high-ranking governmental officials. So it's tough to believe him when he insists that the Chinese government is not financially backing the project, especially when we already know that China is using state-financed companies to buy more and more assets in the West. The opportunity to own the world's most valuable shipping lane seems too tempting for the Chinese government to pass up. The supposedly democratic government of Nicaragua is using a page out of China's playbook, by refusing to release any of the studies about the impacts of the canal until December 2014, the same month construction will begin. That's because there's a long list of environmental and humanitarian concerns. The project will tear through countless ecosystems and communities and rip into the source of much of the country's freshwater, Lake Nicaragua. The residents whose land is on the canal route have received no word on what the government plans to do for them in terms of compensation and relocation. But as easy as it is to criticize the way the project is being handled, it's also fairly hypocritical of me, as an American, to mount a very convincing argument against the plan. After all, about 100 years ago, US President Theodore Roosevelt basically took control of Panama and pushed through the canal there, a project that's benefited America time and time again, and has made Panama economically better off in the long run. But we're not living in 1914. Now is the time of social media-fueled revolution, where images and video fly around the world instantly, empowering even the poorest locals to use the power of the global community to rally support for their cause and exert political pressure in unpredictable ways. So what I'm saying is that it may have been easy for President Ortega to see all that money flying around and secretly, single-handedly, approve a massively disruptful project like this. But when those bulldozers start tearing apart the countryside and people's homes, there's probably... The rulers of the United Arab Emirates have insane amounts of money to spend. Thanks to everyone's thirst for oil, they've been on a construction spree unlike any the world has ever seen for such a small country, investing in one ambitious infrastructure project after another. At one point, 24% of all the world's construction cranes were in Dubai. Unfortunately, that was before the 2008 global financial meltdown, which led to much of the investment in the city drying up faster than the water on somebody who just got out of the pool at the Burj Khalifa. But the government insists that many of these projects have simply been delayed and are putting their money where their mouth is, with the recent approval of a $32 billion expansion of Dubai's Al Maktoum International Airport that will break ground by the end of 2014. When complete, it'll suddenly have the capacity to become the busiest airport in the world in both total passengers at 220 million a year and total cargo of 12 million annual tons of goods that can move through it. That's almost three times more than what takes off from the runways of the world's current leading airport, Hong Kong International. Dubai's terminals will be able to greet 100 of the massive new Airbus A380s at a time. Those things are two-thirds of a football field long and cost $300 million a pop. And the UAE's Emirates Airline already owns more of those planes than anyone else in the world. It's the largest airline in the Middle East and will eventually move into the Al Maktoum to help jumpstart activity there. The government's plan is for the airfield to be the heartbeat of a city within the larger city of Dubai. This littler city is called World Central, which the UAE thinks will be home to around 900,000 residents in the near future. The airport also aims to be the central hub for the emerging Middle East, North African, and South Asian economic bloc known as MENASA. But time will tell whether the Sheikh's vision for Dubai actually becomes a reality or fades like some vicious mirage. This is Songdo International Business District, the world's most futuristic urban area. It's being built 40 miles southwest of the second most populated city in the world, Seoul, South Korea. The $40 billion project is along the waterfront in the city of Incheon, and is embracing two key concepts that urban planners are in love with. The first is Aerotropolis, which means the airport is integrated into the urban center instead of banishing it far outside of the city. This allows for shorter trips to and from the place that's going to get you out of town. This will be an emerging pattern in 21st century planning as air travel continues to become accessible to more and more people in our increasingly interconnected world. Songdo is brilliantly directly connected to the airport via the 7-mile-long Incheon Bridge, so you've just got a straight shot that gets you there in like 10 minutes. It's also got these incredible views, which is the first thing visitors see coming into the city. The other key theme is ubiquitous city, which is a uniquely Korean concept where every device, component, service is linked to an informational network through wireless computing technology, allowing for greater coordination and a more efficient and synchronized city than has ever been possible before. An example of this is Songdo's trash system, which won't rely on garbage trucks because a network of tubes will suck in the garbage straight from the can and, through a system of pipes, transport it efficiently to treatment facilities. Songdo's so dedicated to being a model for sustainability that it's set aside 40% of its land area to be outdoor spaces like parks, and it'll become the first city in the world outside of the United States to achieve LEED certification, which is the highest energy consumption and waste standards possible with currently available technology. As a tip of the hat to other great cities, Songdo will also incorporate replicas of New York's Central Park and Venice's historic canals. Overall, construction is currently half done. It already has 67,000 people living there, studying and working at its many schools, including the foreign campuses of four American universities. But it's struggled to attract Korean businesses, as the government is refusing to give tax incentives for relocation because that would create an unfair playing field, favoring Songdo over other cities in the country. Still, if it stays squarely focused on the future, Songdo's a long-term investment that's likely to pay off. Nicaragua is about to embark on what may be the riskiest mega project in the world, one that will change it forever. It's going to build the biggest canal on the planet. The $50 billion Nicaragua Grand Canal will cut the country in half to connect the Atlantic Ocean with the Pacific, running through the biggest lake in Central America. At 173 miles long, it'll dwarf the 120 mile long Suez Canal in Egypt, and directly compete with the Panama Canal 250 miles to the south, through which more than 15,000 ships already pass each year. But in the coming years, many more ships full of goods and raw materials are going to try and pass back and forth from the Pacific to the Atlantic to connect Europe, Brazil, and the eastern coast of the United States with China and the rest of Asia. The story of how little 6-million-man Nicaragua, the second poorest country in the Western Hemisphere, is able to afford such an expensive project is a fascinating case study of globalization and how capitalism is increasingly driving geopolitical decision-making. In June of last year, Nicaraguan President Daniel Ortega's Sandinista Party also controlled parliament and, without any real debate, gave a 50-year, no-bid contract to Chinese telecommunications magnate Wang Jing to build and manage the proposed canal. And it just so happens that, also last year, according to a report in the LA Times, Wang hosted a number of Nicaraguan officials and businessmen on a trip to China, where the powerful and connected Wang supposedly flaunted his extreme wealth and was accompanied at all times by Chinese military officers and other high-ranking governmental officials. So it's tough to believe him when he insists that the Chinese government is not financially backing the project, especially when we already know that China is using state-financed companies to buy more and more assets in the West. The opportunity to own the world's most valuable shipping lane seems too tempting for the Chinese government to pass up. The supposedly democratic government of Nicaragua is using a page out of China's playbook by refusing to release any of the studies about the impacts of the canal until December 2014, the same month construction will begin. That's because there's a long list of environmental and humanitarian concerns. The project will tear through countless ecosystems and communities and rip into the source of much of the country's freshwater, Lake Nicaragua. The residents whose land is on the canal route have received no word on what the government plans to do for them in terms of compensation and relocation. But as easy as it is to criticize the way the project is being handled, it's also fairly hypocritical of me, as an American, to mount a very convincing argument against the plan. After all, about 100 years ago, US President Theodore Roosevelt basically took control of Panama and pushed through the canal there, a project that's benefited America time and time again, and has made Panama economically better off in the long run. But we're not living in 1914. Now is the time of social media-fueled revolution, where images and video fly around the world instantly, empowering even the poorest locals to use the power of the global community to rally support for their cause and exert political pressure in unpredictable ways. So, what I'm saying is that it may have been easy for President Ortega to see all that money flying around and secretly, single-handedly, approve a massively disruptful project like this, but when those bulldozers start tearing apart the countryside and people's homes, there's probably going to be hell to pay for not consulting the voters at all. This could be shaping up to be another one of those important moments of struggle in world history between the powerful haves and the have-nots. On the one hand, you have the limitless funding of the Chinese who want that flag-in-the-dirt statement-making moment for their country of staking a claim in the Americas. We know the canal would benefit corporations in the West through the shipping and trade benefits I outlined earlier. And with construction set to begin in Nicaragua next month, there doesn't seem to be any stopping it from starting. But on the other hand, this thing is going to take 6 years, at a minimum, to finish. And if we've learned anything from recent history, it's that a lot can happen in 6 weeks or 6 months, let alone 6 years. On a person-to-person basis, the United Arab Emirates has the biggest ecological footprint in the world, thanks to its prolific oil production and the massive construction boom that's been going on there for the last decade. So it's surprising to learn that the UAE is home to Masdar, the world's first zero-carbon, zero-waste city. To meet this ambitious goal, it's powered only by renewable energy, like a 54-acre, 88,000-panel solar farm beyond the city's walls. That's right, I said walls. The designers studied ancient cities to learn the most effective planning methods to reduce energy consumption. One of the key things they found are that walls help to keep the high, hot desert winds away from cities' inhabitants. They also raised the entire foundation of the site a few feet above the surrounding land to keep Masdar cooler and spaced the buildings much closer together to keep the streets and walkways narrow and mostly in the shade. These techniques, combined with 130-foot-tall wind towers that suck air from above and convert it into a cool breeze blowing on the street, mean Masdar is a comfortable 70 degrees Fahrenheit when, just a few meters away, the thermostat rises well above 100. Plus, there's no driving in the city, and any car that enters is parked at the outskirts. A system of driverless electric vehicles then ferry people from place to place underground, and a light rail system is also available above ground, which means there's no need for streets. And in a move that cuts both water and electricity consumption more than half, there are no light switches or water taps. Everything is controlled by movement sensors. This unprecedented level of environmental consciousness has won it hard-earned endorsements from environmental conservation groups like Greenpeace and the World Wildlife Fund. The German engineering giant Siemens has located its Middle East headquarters there, as has the International Renewable Energy Agency. The Masdar Institute for Science and Technology, a small postgraduate university that was founded through a collaboration with MIT, occupies one of Masdar's first completed buildings, and is already producing great work and first-class researchers. So the city undeniably has a solid foundation, but it's got a lot to do still if it's going to meet its ambitious goal of housing 50,000 residents and hosting offices for 60,000 more commuters. The city's co-founder admits that Masdar is, quote, a fraction of what it was supposed to be back in 2006 when we announced it. At the beginning of the project, nobody really anticipated how difficult it is to build a city, end quote. This underscores the point many urban planners around the world have made, that we should be focused on making our existing cities more sustainable instead of building brand new ones. But even if Masdar only teaches us one or two major things about what's possible when it comes to sustainable urban design, and it does seem like it's already done that, then it'll have been worth it, even if it takes much longer to achieve its overall vision, or if it ultimately fails. Because let's be honest, the UAE was going to spend that $20 billion in oil revenue on something, so it's better for everyone that it's going to an important experiment like Masdar, rather than another row of gold and marble-crusted hotel skyscrapers, or an electricity-sucking indoor snow park. This is the future. Maglev trains. Japan's all aboard. They're spending a staggering $85 billion over the next 30 years to connect the island's three largest cities, Tokyo to Nagoya to Osaka. That's over 300 miles that you'll be able to cover in about 67 minutes by racing through the countryside at over 300 miles per hour. Maglev technology uses powerful magnetic charges to move rail cars that float several inches above a concrete guideway, rather than riding on steel wheels. This frictionless system allows for a smoother ride at significantly higher speeds than traditional high-speed rail. In contrast, California's planned high-speed rail system that'll eventually connect San Francisco, LA, and San Diego will only be able to travel at top speeds of 220 miles per hour, but its estimated overall cost is $10 billion less than the Japanese system and will cover a distance 2.5 times as long. The Chinese city of Shanghai has had a short maglev line in operation since 2004, but the Japanese line is the world's first intercity link to gain public approval. The project's called Chuo Shinkansen, or as the Japanese refer to it, Rinia Motoka, and is a culmination of 40 years of Japanese maglev development that began with an unlikely partnership between Japan Airlines and Japanese National Railways. What's really impressive about this project is that JR Central, the company that's building the line, will finance the project without public money, thanks largely to the success of the bullet train it's run from Tokyo to Osaka since the mid-1960s. The company's also pushing hard to construct a maglev line between the American capital city of Washington, D.C. and New York, which would showcase the technology to the American market and the rest of the Western world. The Japanese government has even offered to fully finance the 40-mile first leg of the U.S. project from Baltimore to D.C., a proposal Prime Minister Shinzo Abe directly pitched to President Barack Obama during a meeting last year. but critics of maglev say the costs outweigh the benefits. Opponents have raised questions about the sheer monetary cost of the project, its environmental impact, and whether it's really needed at all. Tunnels will be blasted through some of Japan's highest mountains to build the Chuo Shinkansen line, but regardless of what the critics say, something had to change. When the maglev system is done, it will help alleviate the overcrowding on Japan's existing rail system and make it feasible for commuters into Tokyo to live further outside of the city than they can now. Many of the projects that we've profiled in our Mega Project series have a real purpose for advancing society, or at least meeting the needs of a growing world economy. Then there's Azerbaijan's ridiculous Khazar Islands, a project that, despite all the progress in the world, is the perfect example of everything that's still wrong with its power structure, but more on that in a moment. The creatively named Azerbaijan Tower will be the world's tallest building, about 800 feet taller than the current leader, the Burj Khalifa, and insanely twice as tall as the tallest building in the Western Hemisphere, New York's One World Trade Center. The Freudian showpiece of the $100 billion project, Azerbaijan Tower, will rise above the capital city, Baku, and it'll be surrounded by 55 artificial islands built in the Caspian Sea, with land gathered by completely destroying a nearby mountain. There will also be at least 8 hotels, a Formula One racetrack, a yacht club, and an airport. So basically, we're talking about Donald Trump's fantasy. Now, it's one thing to build an over-the-top city like Dubai in the United Arab Emirates, which is one of the most developed places in the world, and a completely different thing for it to rise in Azerbaijan, which has a per capita GDP that's not even one-fifth as much as the UAE. This madness is the brainchild of the billionaire developer Ibrahim Ibrahimov, who has extremely close ties with the corrupt government of the newly oil-rich nation of Azerbaijan. Just how corrupt is Azerbaijan? In a 2012 report by watchdog Transparency International that declared two-thirds of the world's countries highly corrupt, Azerbaijan's prez, Ilham Aliyev, stood out from the pack as the report's infamous person of the year, with untold amounts of money stashed in various locations around the world. But back to President Aliyev's good buddy, Ibrahimov, who lazily came up with the tacky idea for the mega project that's basically a copy of Dubai's island development and mega tower while on a flight home from, you guessed it, Dubai. He argues that Khazar Islands will be home to 800,000 people, but doesn't explain how those people will afford its expensive apartments. Instead of investing in the future by maybe funding a network of world-class universities, which Azerbaijan isn't even close to having, in a country that borders no ocean and produces no product that the rest of the world wants besides oil, the government thinks it's a good idea to build this. I doubt many of the 9 million people of Azerbaijan think it's a very good idea. In fact, in a possible sign of things to come, last year, Azerbaijanis, in a city across the country, got so fed up with the corrupt regime, they rioted for 2 entire days. But look, the capital is doing some things right. Baku made Lonely Planet's top 10 ranking of the best nightlife spots in the world. I just wonder how much they paid to get on that list. No list of mega projects would be complete without including the largest ever science project. The International Thermonuclear Experimental Reactor, or ITER, is a collaboration between China, the European Union, India, Japan, Russia, South Korea, and the United States that is under construction in southern France, where researchers will attempt to see if they can, essentially, recreate the power of the sun and harness it in a steel bottle. Gas will be heated to over 150 million degrees in a massive steel frame using giant magnets that will force some atoms together. In this experimental reactor, the hope is to produce 10 times more energy than what is used to initiate the reaction, or the equivalent of 500 megawatts of power for 1,000 seconds. Although electricity won't be generated at the ITER facility, a fusion plant based on this design would use the heat generated to drive turbines and produce power. Unlike nuclear fission, which are what all nuclear power plants are today, fusion reactors should be completely safe, with no risk of producing a runaway chain reaction and no dangerous long-living radioactive waste. The fact that nations who are competing in nearly every area of geopolitics and economics are coming together to collaborate on a $50 billion project is a sign that the science is incredibly promising and the potential benefits to humanity are profoundly game-changing. That's why countries that represent half the world's population and account for two-thirds of the global economy are participating, because solving fusion would mean prosperity for all, the closest thing to limitless energy we can fathom. This month, after the completion of the ground support structure, which took 4 years to finish, the second phase of construction began. The walls of the seven-story building where the experiment will take place. But we're still several years away from turning the thing on. The complex will make its first attempt to produce plasma in a fusion reaction in 2020, with regular operations beginning in 2027, 11 years behind schedule and over 40 years after the program was first initiated in 1985. But no matter how long or how many tries it takes to get it right, the hope of living in a world powered by this type of energy that we wouldn't need to fight over or pump out of the ground, that we wouldn't need to burn, that wouldn't harm our precious planet, that's probably one of the most optimistic, hopeful ideas I've ever heard, and it's definitely one worth waiting for. China is about halfway done building the largest expressway system in the world. And it's been doing so at a feverish pace over the last 25 years to keep up with the rise of the automobile as the country, and the world, has shifted away from a rail-based transportation system. The first expressway within the National Trunk Highway System, as it's called, opened in 1988, and today, just 26 years later, the system is over 65,000 miles long. In the 10 years since 2004, the network has tripled in length. Each year, China's now building new expressways equivalent in length to the distance of going coast to coast and back in the United States. The Chinese system exceeded the total length of the US interstate highway system back in 2011. This crazy expansion has happened because the Chinese have embraced the car at a staggering pace. This next mind-blowing fact pretty much sums up this entire video. As the country's middle class boomed and tens of millions of people suddenly could afford to buy cars in the 20 years from 1985 to 2005, the number of passenger vehicles in China increased from 19,000 to 62 million cars on the road. That's a mind-blowing increase of 323,000%. And that 62 million number is more than tripling to 200 million by 2020. That's why we've seen those stories that I thought were a joke the first time I read them, of traffic jams around Beijing stretching over 60 miles and lasting for 11 days. So this project is sorely needed, simply for the country to function. When it's finished, it'll have cut total travel times between cities throughout the country by half on average. Overall, the total cost of building the entire system is $240 billion. That's easily the biggest infrastructure project in human history, with $12 billion a year being invested through 2020. It's being able to afford to do this without adding a national fuel tax, because 95% of the system are toll roads owned by private for-profit companies. This is a problem, as tolls are expensive at over 10 cents per mile, which is more than the cost of fuel itself. But regardless of how the roads are paid for, or whether you drive in them in your gas or electric car, or ride in a self-driving car in the future, the Chinese economy and quality of life of its people will be significantly better thanks to this ambitious project. It seems the whole country is embracing the Chinese saying, Lutong Keitan, wealth follows the extension of motorways. India faces one of the most challenging situations in the world. It has 1.2 billion people spread over a vast country, more than 350 million of whom will move into cities in the coming decade, which means some 500 new urban centers will need to be built from scratch. And even though India's sheer size means that its economy ranks third in the world in purchasing power, overall it's relatively poor and underdeveloped. It's also young. The average Indian is just 27 years old, compared to the average American, who's a decade older. This means that most of the population is about to hit their prime working years. These are all people who need jobs to be created now. That's why the government is embarking on the largest infrastructure project in Indian history, the $90 billion Delhi-Mumbai Industrial Corridor, whose backbone will be a 920-mile-long dedicated freight corridor, basically a set of multiple rail lines that will exist solely to move goods from the factories where they are produced to the sea and airports where they can be exported to market. It's designed to cut the logistical costs of manufacturing goods, to make India the cheapest place in the world for a company to build its stuff, and, in turn, triple the amount of merchandise it exports from 2010 levels by 2017. Japan is the major partner behind the project because the Japanese economy is based on a technology industry that needs to build its products at the most competitive rates in the world. The overall effort will include a 4,000 megawatt power plant and at least 3 brand new seaports and 6 airports. And all along the route, 24 new cities will spring up, with each aiming to be superior to any existing Indian city in terms of the quality of infrastructure, planning, management, and services offered. With natural resources scarce, and climate change a concern of any good urban planner, the use of technology has been stressed to make sure this boom will be as clean and sustainable as possible. Roads are also a major part of the plan, with thousands of miles of expressways planned to ease congestion. The project is a priority of Prime Minister Narendra Modi, who entered office in 2014 after leading his BJP party to a dominating win in the 2014 election, giving him a mandate to enact his vision for making India a global manufacturing superpower. It seems the Indians are attempting to follow a similar blueprint for success the Chinese put into action over the last 40 years. With a population nearly as big, Indians are rightly asking, why not us? If you were playing SimCity, you'd want to go about building your metropolis the same way the Saudis have with King Abdullah Economic City. And just like other great leaders of men, you'd probably name it after yourself too, which is exactly what King Abdullah did. You'd also focus on job-creating infrastructure and a dream university to attract the best and brightest. Saudi Arabia is the world's dominant oil producer and is a country that knows how to play the game. While its flashier neighbors like Abu Dhabi and Dubai get all the publicity for their mega projects, the kingdom is embarking on a far more ambitious project that's focused squarely on creating the most cohesive, well-planned city in the Arab world. The $100 billion enterprise on the coast of the Red Sea is about an hour's drive north of Jeddah, the second largest city in Saudi Arabia, and plans to expand into an area about the size of Washington, D.C. That location is no coincidence, says Fahd al-Rashid, the man who's in charge of growing King Abdullah Economic City, which we're going to just shorten to its initials KAEC for the purpose of this video. Quote, "You're talking about 24% of global trade going through the Red Sea, and this is a trend that's never been addressed by a Red Sea port." End quote. That's why KAEC's port is going to be massive, with an annual capacity of over 10 million shipping containers, which would make it one of the busiest ports in the world. So cargo is KAEC's first major transportation hub. The second is Haramain Station, one of 4 stops on Saudi Arabia's planned high-speed rail network that will connect the new megacity to Jeddah, Mecca, and Medina. This will bring thousands of visitors to KAEC right from its inception, with officials hoping that some will naturally take jobs and stay there, fueling its expansion. At first, the whole plan struggled to gain much traction with investors, but, says al-Rashid, then we reoriented ourselves toward building that demand, creating that support, and it's completely shifted. Now we have captive demand, all our apartments are full, and we have waiting lists for hundreds of people, literally." End quote. Part of that shift focused on KAEC's industrial valley, which is centered on a large petrochemical plant and has more than 70 countries lining up to set up bases there. And then there's the cornerstone of any thriving city, a great university. Enter King Abdullah University of Science and Technology, which began instruction in 2009 with a staggering $20 billion endowment, making it the 3rd best-funded university in the world behind Harvard and Yale. This capital injection has allowed it to lift off like a rocket in its first 5 years. It's recruited some of the best talent from over 60 countries around the world, scientists who've carried the school to an eye-opening 99.9% research record score. The research teams at King Tech are advancing many important fields like solar cell technology and cancer therapy. It teaches in English and is the first mixed-gender university in the kingdom. Plus, with just 1,200 postgraduates on an 8,900-acre campus, there's plenty of room to expand in every direction. With 40% of Saudi Arabia's citizens under 15 years old, the plan is for the megacity, by itself, to create upwards of 1 million jobs for all of those young people to grow into. In the end, it may be true that Saudi Arabia would be a bone-dry desert wasteland without its exploitation of the vast fields of black gold underneath it, but at least, in the twilight of his life, King Abdullah is doing all he can to set his people and the rest of the world on a slightly better path than the one they were on when he took over just 9 years ago in 2005. And if that's his legacy, he deserves to have a city named after him. Thanks for watching. I hope you enjoyed this video, and if you did, you'll love our video profiling 10 promising renewable energy sources of the future, or our mini doc on robotic armies and the militaries of the future. Make sure to like this video to help it spread, it really helps us out, and hit that subscribe button to stay up to date on all of our daily videos. For TDC, I'm Bryce Plank. The rulers of the United Arab Emirates have insane amounts of money to spend. Thanks to everyone's thirst for oil, they've been on a construction spree unlike any the world has ever seen for such a small country, investing in one ambitious infrastructure project after another.